wire together. This works well as a separate file. So if you want to build your tire and rim separately and then import it into your scene, this technique will work really well for you. So let's get going. The first thing we want to do is get some reference imagery. So I'm going to go ahead and go through my little scroll book here of pictures. And I'm going to find an image that actually has a tire kind of in a three-quarter view and kind of less distorted. So I really like this one. So I'm going to go ahead and open it. That's absolutely perfect for what I need. So I'm going to go ahead and open this image in Photoshop.
Are you recording?
Yes. So I'm going to open this picture with Photoshop. How come it doesn't allow? So I'm going to launch Photoshop. And I'm just going to drag my image into Photoshop to open it. And then I'm going to turn on the layers window. Now what I want to do here is I'm just kind of trying to figure out from a relative standpoint how big all these pieces of my tire and rim are in relation to each other. So what I want to do is I'm going to create a layer here. And I'm just going to go ahead and draw a red line. So I'm going to use the brush tool. I'm going to give it a nice bright red color. And then I'm going to go ahead and pick a portion of my image that actually has a feature. So right here, I'm going to use the tire. And I'm just going to hold down my shift key. And I'm going to draw a line from the base of the tire to the top of the tire. Okay. And unfortunately, I did that on the wrong layer, so I'm going to do it again. There we go. Shift key so it's straight. So what I've done here is I've created a red line that is one tire length, okay? And I'm trying to figure out how big all this stuff is in relation to each other before I start modeling and everything ends up kind of wrong. So what I'm going to do is I have one tire length as my unit of measure, and I'm going to duplicate this line, and now I'm going to find out how big my rim is. So my rim is approximately three tires, in diameter. And then I have one more dimension I want to figure out, which is the width of the tire itself. So I'm going to duplicate another one of these. I'm going to hit Control T to translate that, rotate it. And I want to see how wide this tire is. So I'm going to measure kind of from this tread here to this tread here. And so it looks like it's about maybe 1 1/5, somewhere in there. We could say 1 1/4 if we wanted to. Okay, so we have all these proportions. And now we want to set up an arbitrary scale. So let's just say that these are 20-inch rims, okay? So that's a 20. So I'm going to go into Maya, and I'm going to go ahead and create a NURBS primitive circle. And I'm going to make it 20 units. Currently, my scale is set up to centimeters, but that's okay because this is all arbitrary, so it doesn't matter. We're just really trying to get this thing built with correct proportions so that we don't end up with an wonky, weird-looking tire when we're done. So radius 20. I want radius 10, which will make it 20 units in diameter. Okay? So there we go. That's the dimensions for our rim. And then we know that our tire is approximately 3 of those. So if we divide 3 by 20 by 3, is that, no, I'm sorry. Our tire is 1/3 of that. So the tire, we could just say, is approximately 6 or 7 inches tall. So let's go ahead and do that. So I'm just going to draw a NURBS curve, a CV curve, and I'm going to make it, let's just say six inches is good. So I'm just going to draw a linear NURBS curve that's 6 units tall to basically act as a placeholder for how tall my tire is in relation to the rim, okay? So now what we want to do is we want to figure out what is the circumference of the tire itself. So if the tire is 26 units or 6 units, and my rim is 20 units, so then if I duplicate this tire to the other side, that's actually going to add 12 units. So it's 32 units for the diameter of my tire from the outside. Does that make sense? And if I want to, I can just go ahead and do that by duplicating this circle. And we'll make it, 32, 16. Oops. And of course, there's no history on that circle. So let's go ahead and create a new one. The second one, we're going by radius here, so it's 16, I believe. It would be 32. Okay. And now I have all my placeholders in here. And the importance of the exterior radius of my tire is that I want to figure out exactly how long to make my tread. So let's go ahead and center this up on the origin. So we have our rim, our tire, diameter. And we want to make our tread so that it has the correct length so that when I bend it, it'll bend perfectly into the right shape, okay? So what I'm going to do here is the equation for figuring out your tread length is the diameter of your tire times pi. So let's go to accessories, calculator, and if you go to view, you can go to scientific. And so the diameter of my tire is 32 times pi. So 100.53, all right? So now what I want to do is go into the top view, and I'm going to create a polygon primitive plane. And I'll just make it square to start with, okay? And then now I'm going to go into its construction parameter, and I'm going to change the width to 105. What did it say again? I always forget. 100.53. Okay. All right. So that represents the length of my tread if it were all laid out flat. Okay. And then the width is probably what did we say it was? 6. Plus 0.25. So let's go ahead and 6 times 1.25, 7.5 y, okay? All right. So now what we have is a representation of our tire tread all laid out on a plane. And then I'm just going to go ahead and move it up to be at the top of my tire here. And I'm going to save my scene, okay? The next thing I want to do is I want to count the number of features on my tread. So I'm going to go and go to that same image, and I'm going to count the features, which are these little knobbies here. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, okay? So I have 15 knobbies. So an easy way for me to denote that on this tread here is just simply to select it and go into the construction parameters and add 15 subdivisions. And so what each one of these subdivisions represent is a placement of each one of those knobbies that I need to put on the tire, all right? So just to give you a preview of how this is going to work when we're done, we're going to build this thing flat because if we built it in circular form, it would be really painful, and we would not have a good time doing that, and it probably wouldn't turn out that well. So what we're going to do here is we're going to build it flat first, and then we're going to apply a bend modifier to it. And the way you do that is you go to animate. Where is it? Create deformer. Nonlinear bend, okay? And so you guys are familiar with the bend modifier. So it comes in kind of not in the way that we want it oriented. So I'm going to change it to negative 90. And then I'm going to go ahead and test it. Oops. There we go. So you see here that when I bend the tread, and if I do a curvature of 3.141 or 3.142, which is essentially pi, rounded off, this thing closes up on itself perfectly. So we're going to get, we're not going to end up with any errors when we go to weld this thing together because it's going to line up. So the math that I just did is kind of important if you don't want to find yourself in a position where you're pulling points at the last minute. If you want this thing to all work out mathematically, this is how you do it. Okay? So I just wanted to test that and show that it's going to work. So now let's go ahead and take that bend and remove the curvature. And we'll go ahead and hide it too, because we don't really need it. And let's go ahead and start working on the tread, all right? So the first thing we need to do whenever you do a tire tread is you need to figure out where the repetition is in the pattern. So I'm going to go back to my nifty little reference images. I'm going to try to find a picture where I have a direct-on view of the tread. And so this one looks pretty good. There's a little bit of perspective to it, but you know what? For government work, this will work. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this image, and I'm going to open it in Photoshop. We don't need this image anymore because I've already figured out the relative scale. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to zoom in on the tread itself, and I'm going to go ahead and crop the image kind of I'm going to crop the image on the center of the treads here, and I'm going to do it as a square. The reason for that is because it's going to make my life easier in Maya. So I'm just going to go ahead and go in here, and that looks pretty good. There's a little bit of a shadow there, but this is going to work fine. I'm going to try to center up this up as much as possible, and then I'm going to go ahead and crop the image. And then I'm going to go ahead and save this image as tread ref. Zero one. I'm going to save that. Okay. Now what I can do is I can go into Maya, and I'll do this from the top view, and I can create a polygon plane. I'll hold down the shift key to make it square, and then I can center it up on the origin if I want to. And now I'm going to go ahead and assign that picture. So I'm going to go to assign new material. I'm going to do a Lambert because there's no highlights. I click on the checkerboard to get the assigned file. I click on the file, which allows me to navigate to the path where that image is. So I'm going to go to the desktop, car tutorial, and it is tire, I believe, tire tread ref. So I'm going to apply that image, and then I'm going to hit the 6 key to show the texture. Now what I can do is I'm going to turn off my snapping. I'm just going to pull this reference plane up to be above my tread reference. And I'm going to rotate it 90 degrees. And what this represents here is one cross section of this tread. And I know that I counted the exterior dimension to be 15 treads. But then if you look on the other side, it's kind of offset here. So if this is symmetrical, which I believe it is, then I know that these two treads here actually make up one rectangular block of my tread that repeat around the entire wheel. Okay? So if I want to place this kind of accurately or semi-accurately, I'm going to just pull this reference plane to be slightly below it now. And then I'm going to go into the top view, and I'm going to turn on my X-ray view mode so I can kind of see through the plane. And I'm going to just try to line this thing up, kind of centered on my patch, which represents my repeating tread, the 15 that I need. And then I'm going to try to also center it up. And I'm never going to get it 100% centered, so at a certain point I just have to stop and start making it up. So that's what I'm going to do. I have this placed reasonably well, and now I'm in a position to where I can go ahead and start modeling my actual tread that I'm going to use. So now I'm going to go into polygon mode, and I'm going to say mesh, create polygon tool, and I'm just going to draw this tread. I'm just going to trace it. So let's. I'm going to simplify it a bit, just because, again, if you modeled it to the entire detail that it actually exists, I'd never get through the lecture. So I'm going to holding down the shift key when I drew my second point in order to keep it straight, and then I'm going to hold down the shift key again to keep that one straight. Shift key, and then now I can draw this one. We want shift key, straight, and then shift key. There we go. So again, that's not perfect to what the tread actually is, but it's a pretty good approximation. I'm done with that one, so I'm going to go ahead and commit the changes. Now I'm going to go to vertex mode on the polygon I just drew to represent the tread. And my little my tread reference is kind of getting in the way. And so what I want to do is I'm going to select that, and I'm going to go ahead and create a layer for it. And I'm going to reference it so that we can see it, but that I'm not having trouble constantly selecting it. And I'm going to do the same thing for my my reference plane here. Okay, so now I'm going to select this, and I'm going to go into vertex mode. And I just want to edit any vertices that I think are a little off base or not quite what I want. I'm going to flatten these up with respect to the edge of my tread. Okay, that looks pretty good. And then the other thing is, I do know that I looked at this thing in advance, and I do know that this portion of the tread is supposed to be lined up on the center of the grid. So what I want to do is I'm going to move this to be at the center of my grid so that that's going to work exactly how I want. Now I know I'm off a little bit from the photograph at this point, but that's totally fine, because at a certain point you have to start manipulating it. Again, the photos are fraught with distortion, and so you have to kind of correct for that later. So let's go ahead and now we're ready to draw the other portion of the tread. So I'm going to go to mesh, create polygon tool. I'm going to hold down the shift keys to make that straight. And then I'm going to draw shift key again. Okay, so that represents one side of the tread. Again, I'm going to go into the vertex mode, and I'm going to straighten these guys up if I can. That looks pretty good. That looks pretty good. Okay. So now we have our two polygons drawn. Now we probably need to split these up, because currently they're both kind of illegal faces. So they each one of these has way too many sides. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go out into the viewport, and I'm going to move these up away from the origin, and I'm going to put them above my tread plane. Just a little bit. Okay. And now I want to go in and go into the edit mesh interactive split tool, And I want to divide this thing up. And I want to divide this one up also. So we have our treads made here, and now we can kind of figure out how tall we want to make them. So if we wanted to, we could go over there and look at the Photoshop file again. I don't think that's necessary. At this point, we can just go ahead and guesstimate. So I'm going to select both of the treads. I'm going to combine them now that we have them subdivided. If I wanted to, I could straighten this vertex up to make it coincide with the other one. And then I could select all these and scale them down to flatten those out as well. And same thing for here. That's fine. Okay. All right, so now we're ready to go ahead and extrude this thing. So I'm going to select it, and I'm going to go to face mode, select all those faces. I'm going to say edit mesh, extrude. I'm going to do it in world mode because I don't want to introduce any sort of distortion. And then the tread on this tire is pretty high. So let's go ahead and guesstimate. Maybe a little bit higher than that. Okay, that's good. Now there's something interesting about this tread. Normally, if you have a performance tire and the tread does not go down the side of the boundary, the side of the tire, we would already be done, right? Because I'd just be able to take this thing, duplicate it over, offset it, and then make a bunch of them. But the problem with this tire, if you look at the reference images, is that the tread actually wraps about halfway down the side of the tire. So we're actually going to have to do that in the model. It just would not be easy to do later. So I chose this wheel for this reason, because some of you guys will have easy tires and some of you won't. And I wanted to show you how to be able to do one that did have a tread that actually wrapped down the side. So because of that, what we're going to do is we're going to have to model that in. So we have our tread here. And now I need to create the side profile that wraps down the side of the tire. So in order to do that, I think before I even begin, yeah, I want to kind of draw a profile of the tire itself to make sure that I have the tire shape reasonably correct before I go ahead and start modeling detail. So I'm just going to take a look at my reference image. And I just kind of want to figure out what the profile is for that tire. It looks like it's really flat all the way across. It's got one hard edge, and then it's got the typical tire bend to it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into the front viewport here. And I'm going to draw that shape out. So I'm going to say create CV curve tool. I want to make sure I'm doing a linear. Okay, and I'm going to snap to the origin first and turn off the snapping. I'm going to hold down the shift key so that I'm drawing this thing straight to the edge of my tire here. And then now I can go ahead and start drawing my curvature of my wheel. And I'm even going to draw that interior shape where the tire has kind of a little nodule that allows it to catch the rim. Okay? So I can check my work also. I kind of drew that by eyeball and I wing it. If I want to check my work or use a reference curve, I can use my rim and just extrude it out here. And now I know exactly how long I want to make that. So I'm just going to center the pivot on that curve that I just drew. Hit insert, and I'm going to move the insert to the base of the curve itself. And then I think I'm just going to pull the points. I was considering scaling it, but I think I'm just going to pull them. There's not that many. Thank you. And the beauty of doing it this way is that all the way along the process, you're kind of getting happy with everything you do and you don't end up with any surprises. I just find that modeling in this manner is way more efficient than doing it five different times. So I'm going to move that. Okay, and now we have our curve here that represents our tire. We've got a decent profile. Now we just want to check it, so I'm going to change the insert to be at the origin. And I'm going to grab my profile curve of my tire, and I'm going to go ahead and make a test tire here. So I'm going to go to Surfaces, Revolve, and I want to revolve it around the Z-axis. And the number of segments, for your tires, you want to, normally 32 is what most people say if you want it to be a photoreal, but you probably want to go a little bit higher than that, anywhere higher than, say, 52, and I actually kind of like 64. So you want to stay over 52, but you can go as high as, I don't know, you can go into the hundreds if you want. So let's just go ahead and use 64 as my placeholder. I'm going to apply it. And you can see here that 64 is a reasonably decent number to build your tire here. All right? So I have one half the tire. That's fine. I actually wanted to have two both sides because I'm going to use this basically as a placeholder to check my work all the way along the process. So I'm going to select this curve. And I want to make another one. I just want to mirror it. So there is no mirror tool for NURBS curves, so I like to use the duplicate special. I always reset it first. And I want to mirror it in Z. So you do it by using the scale. So we have scale X, Y, and Z. So I need our negative one for Z. I'll say apply. And there we go. Now I have my tire mirrored across. Now I can grab both those curves. I want to delete the history off them first. Whenever you're working with NURBS curves, it's really important that you just keep deleting the history. So I may say modify. Where is it? What's that? Oh, sorry. Edit, delete by type, history, and I'm going to make a button so I don't have to hunt for that again. And I'm going to delete the history. Now I'm going to select both those curves. And I'm going to go into Surfaces, and I'm going to say Attach Curves, and delete the history one more time, and then I'm going to go ahead and revolve it again. So Surfaces, Revolve, bingo. We have our little placeholder tire. That looks good. So I'm going to create a layer for that and template that as well. Okay, so now we're ready to go ahead and model our tread to kind of go down the side of the tire. So, and we are saying that we like this curve, or this arc of the tire, so it gives me something to model to. So I'm going to go ahead and select my tread. I'm going to go into face mode. I'm going to select both my faces here, and I'm going to say polygons, edit mesh, extrude. I want to do this in world mode, and I want to turn my snapping off. And what I need here is I need the same number of edges that my side profile tire actually has. So I'm going to do this once, and I'm going to make sure that I can see the wireframe on this. And I'm just going to drop it down. Okay. And then I'm going to extrude it again. This time from the bottom set of edges, our faces. I'm going to do it in world mode again. And then I'm going to extrude it again, world mode again, And I'm going to flatten this out at this point. And I'm going to just match this up with my tread or my tire, which I've already decided I like the profile of it. Okay, and I'm going to extrude it again. Go to world mode. Okay, that looks pretty good. That's about, let's see if that, actually I think I need a few more. Let's check to see how far we need to go down to approximate that tread. And looks like I need to go down a little bit more. It comes down about half the tire, and right now we're only at about quarter. So let's go ahead and extrude it one more time. World mode. And it looks like we need one more. Okay, that's pretty good. All right, I'm liking that. If you wanted to, we could go into vertex mode here and just fatten these up a little bit. I need to resist doing fine tweaks like this, or else I'll never get through it. Okay. So that's looking pretty good. All right, now we need to define the shape for the side of the tread. So we have this kind of like diagonal shape here on the top side of the tread. Let's see what, I know there's a shape on the front side, on the sidewall, but I believe it actually goes opposite to this one. So let's go ahead and take a look at that. So sure enough, I have this sidewall here, and then there's a notch here, and it basically mimics the same thing. So what I want to do here is I want to combine all these. I'm going to go into face mode. And I'm just going to delete out faces on the inside of my tread. And then I'm going to select all these edges. And I'm going to bridge them. So I'm going to go to Edit Mesh Bridge. I'm going to turn on the settings. I want the number of divisions to be 0. Linear path. And I'm going to apply. And now I've closed that shape off on the inside. And I might have added one extra edge I didn't want. Oh, I know what I did. I wanted to delete these faces, sorry. So I'm just going to do that same process again. I accidentally didn't delete a couple of the faces. And we'll do it again. Bridge. What happened? I'm going to try the bridge offset to fix this. Perfect. So what was happening was it was just lining up the wrong edges. The way you fix that is by going to the bridge offset, and you can dial it to whatever you want. In this case, an offset of 1, cut it back to the correct edge orientation, and we're back on the overall here. So the next thing I want to do is now I want to shape the front of this tread to be the same shape as my tread in the picture. So let's check that one more time. So we have a notch here, and then we have a notch on the same side. So it goes like this. And I do know that it also goes approximately to the edge of this piece of tread right here. So I'm going to select all these vertices right here. I'm going to go out into my front viewport, and I'm going to move this thing over. Deselect. Move over. Deselect. And I just want to check it one more time. As I think, I didn't allow it to drop down enough. I did not. It starts here. And I don't have to be exact, but that's approximately the shape. Okay, that looks pretty good. So now I can go into my tread itself, and I just need to bridge a few more edges because I have these edges in here that are open. So if I hide, everything else. I'm going to go in here to my tread, and I just want to close these edges that are currently open. So I'm going to go into edge mode. I'm going to select these two edges. You can do this also with the append to polygon tool. It's really just a matter of personal preference. I like the bridge tool a little bit better. So I can go in here and select them all. And I say edit mesh bridge. That time it didn't work. I'm going to try to do these one at a time. Edit mesh, bridge, look at the equal number of border edges. And, oh, I know what I did. I want to delete these back sides of these faces. I don't really need those. Okay, and I don't need the bottom faces either. And now I should be able to bridge these. If I go to edge mode. There we go. And then I just hit the G key again to bridge it one more time. Okay, so I'm almost done with my tread here. I've got it modeled in height, and then I also have the sidewall for the tire. Now what I need to do is just figure out the placement for it for the opposite tread, okay? So what I want to do here is I'm going to turn back on my reference tread. And I want to create a center line on this thing. And the way I'm going to do that is currently I have 15 sections. So if I want a center line down each section, all I need to do is convert the number of sections to 30. So under polyplane, I'm going to change the subdivision to 30. And now I have a center line down each one of my treads. Okay. And so now I'm going to center the pivot. And I also want to create a center line down the horizontal axis also. So I'm going to select my polyplane, and I'm going to change the subdivision to 2. And now I have a center. I have vertices from which to center my tire treads. So I'm going to select my tread. I hit insert for the pivot. I'm going to hold down V to snap the vertex. And I'm going to snap it to be at the center of the tread and the center of that feature line. Okay. And that looks good. So now what I can do is I can use the duplicate special to duplicate this tread over to the other side exactly how I need it to be. So from the image, I know it's mirrored in Z, but it's also mirrored in X. So I'm selecting the tread. I'm going to freeze its transformations first. I'm going to delete its history as well. And then I'm going to go ahead and go to Edit, Duplicate Special. And instead of negative 1, I'm going to do negative 1, 1, and negative 1. And apply, and there we go. Boom. So now I have my treads. They're perfectly mirrored in relation to each other. And now all I have to do is make them combined, and then I can go ahead and start duplicating them and create my tire. So if I was going to do this for real, I would also add a, and we'll go ahead and do it. This might slow the lecture down, but let's do it anyway, just because I'm a stickler for this kind of stuff. So we have our tread here, and we need to add a bevel. And I'm only going to bevel the exterior portion of the tread itself. I'm going to do that to kind of save polygon, but also to save time. So I'm going to go to Edit Mesh, Bevel, Fly, and I guess for the speed of this lecture, let's just, I can't help myself. I want to make it fast, but I can't. I want the number of segments to be 2, because that leaves 3 edges, which we know is the minimum number. 3 edges for every 90 degrees of arc. So added an extra edge there because I had it selected, so I don't want that one. I'm going to say Edit Mesh, Bevel, Segment 2. That looks pretty good. Let's go ahead and run with that. Okay, so I'm going to go to Object Mode. See here I have these faces that don't have a material on it anymore. That's because they've either lost their mapping coordinates or they've been assigned a zero material. So the way to fix that is to just select it and say assign existing material. Lambert. There we go. Okay, now I'm ready to go ahead and duplicate this thing because I have my smoothing assigned to it. And I'm going to do the same thing. Edit, Duplicate, Special. My settings were already in place. That looks great. Okay, now I have to basically make this thing so that it's the same dimensions as the section of this square here. All right. So the way I want to do that is I'm going to go into Edge Mode. And I'm only going to select the exterior edges. And I'm going to select them all the way down. Only on the side, okay? I'm going to say Edit Mesh Extrude. I'm going to go into World Mode. And what I'm trying to do here is I'm trying to create a plane to where I can basically marry these two disparate treads together. Okay. And I'm going to do the same thing on the other side. This one I'm going to carry all the way out to the edge of my feature line. Okay. And then now that I've done that, I can go, I have enough edges to where I can duplicate this thing again. I'm going to duplicate special. And we can start sewing these guys together. So now that I just did that, I realized that I should extrude this edge one more time. The first thing I want to do is flatten these verts out and make them all planar. I'm going to go to edge mode. And then I'm going to extrude them one more time. Take them out to the extent of my feature locator. Okay, that looks good. And then let's go ahead and duplicate this special. There we go. We have a mirror image of each other. Now that I have the other one over there, I can line this set of verts up a little bit better. I'm going to flatten it again. And I'm going to try to line it up with that edge right there as much as I can. That looks good. And then I'm going to duplicate it again. Okay, so that's looking pretty good. Now we can go ahead and combine these guys and bridge them together. So let's go ahead and do that. I'm gonna, before I do this though, I wanna save. I'm gonna duplicate this tread here, Control D, and I'm gonna create another layer. And I'm gonna call this original. It's just like when you're working in Photoshop and you wanna do really complex manipulation on a layer. If you always want to get back to that original layer, it's just a good idea to save that guy in case something goes drastically awry. So I'm going to select, now that I've created my duplicate, hidden that, move it down. Now I can select the other one, and I can say mesh combine. And now I can go about the business of bridging all these. So the first thing I want to do before I start bridging is I want to check the face normal. And they're pretty wacky. It looks like they're all just inverted. So I'm going to say normal, reverse. That looks good. Okay. I'm going to turn them off by just clicking face normals again. Now I'm going to go into edge mode. And I want to start bridging this thing together. So I'm going to say edit mesh, bridge. Bridge. Just hitting the G key to repeat the bridge function. Bridge. And bridge. Okay, there we go. So we have one tread completely modeled. And what do you think we're going to do with that? All we need to do is center the pivot. And then all I have to do is place the pivot at the center of my grid line, my tread placement line that I made. I'm going to hold down the V key. I'm going to hit insert. Whoops. I'm going to hit the insert key to get to the center mode. I'm going to hold down the vertex snapping, V for vertex snap. I'm going to snap it to the center of my tread reference. I'm going to hit insert. And then all I have to do is duplicate. Hold down V and snap it. And you can see here that the first thing happens when I go to duplicate it over is that the treads don't actually match up. So what I'm going to have to do is I'm going to have to collapse one side of this. So it's pretty easy. All I'm going to do is use this one as a reference. And I'm going to go to vertex mode. Hold down my V key to snap the vertex. And if I make another one of these, control duplicate, hold on V key for vertex mapping, move it forward, go to vertex, hold on V to snap the vertex. I'm just going to layer that right on top of the other one. All I did was I just collapsed those two vertices where it didn't line up. And then if I duplicate it again, now we have a perfect seam where these things will sew together perfectly, and it will do it either way. So there we go. If So now all it is a matter of grabbing all these and making the appropriate number of duplicates. And then the same thing on the other side. Control D, V for snap the vertex. 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 And bingo. Who would have guessed? It's going to lay out perfectly. And let's just go ahead and count the number of treads. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So we got it right. Now, before I go in and spend the time to sew all these together, I'm just going to go ahead and combine them and check my work to see if this thing looks good. So let's just, or if I need to do any more manipulation to the treads. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to select the middle one. I'm going to duplicate it, and I'm going to send it to that originals folder because just in case I screw something up here, I want to be able to get back. So select them all. We'll say mesh combine. And then I go into animation, create deformers, nonlinear, bend. We'll rotate it down, negative 90. And curvature 3.141. If you do 3.141, it'll leave a slight gap between the border, which I kind of like. If you do 142, it'll overlap it completely. And that's fine if you know where to look for it. It can be good though to just do the 3.141, and then you have a little match there for where it is. So let's go ahead and preview our tire, and we can go ahead and render it. There we go. We got the tire tread. So that looked decent. I probably made a slight mistake in the scale of the actual tread. See how there's too much of a gap here between? So somewhere in there I did it, and I made a slight mistake. Now the beauty of this is that because I saved that extra tread, I'm not going to fix it for the class, but because I made that extra tread, all I have to do is go in and fix it and then duplicate them again, and this would be a non-issue. But for the sake of finishing the exercise, we'll go ahead and pretend like it's perfect. So now if I want to go ahead and finish off my wheel, all I need to do is I can sew all these together and then finish the wheel by extruding it, or I could go ahead and select this curve, this profile curve that I've made, and I could basically extrude it around the same number of edges. I think because of the complexity of the tire and the tread, I'm going to take the first route, which is to go ahead and sew all my pieces together and then extrude the edges of the tire to make the rest of the tire. So let's go ahead and do this. If I did everything precisely enough, I'm going to be able to go in here and go into vertex mode. And we know here that at the intersections of these tie-off to the tries is basically where my tire sections overlap. So I just want to kind of zoom in a little close. And I want to find out what the threshold is in order to merge these vertices. So I selected the vert at the border, and now I am going into Polygons, Edit Mesh, Merge, and I'm trying to find a threshold that will merge them, but not merge the other vertices. So I'm trying the default, which is 0.01. That's not working. So I'll try 0.05. And that looked pretty good. So let's just go ahead and check. Did it weld any of the ones on the side? No, got them all. So now all I have to do is go down to all these borders, select the vert, hit the G key. I really wish I hadn't made that mistake because I built this perfectly at home. It's always the pressure of doing it in front of an audience. Okay, I've got them all welded. So my bend is still on there. All I need to do now is go to it. And do 3.141. Okay. And then I just need to weld that final set of vertices. Is right there. And let's see if my threshold of 0.05 works. Perfectly. Okay, I got my tire with the tread, mathematically correct, and completely finished here. So now if I go in and go into edge mode, and I did a shift select to select all the edges around. And I'm going to do the same thing on the other side. Select the edge, shift select. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to build the sidewall of the tire using the tire that has the tread on it. So let's go ahead and turn on wireframe so I can actually see my tire profile. And I'm going to go ahead and go to edit mesh extrude. Whoa, what happened there? This is a great example of deleting the history before you do an operation like this. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to make a duplicate of this object. And then I'm going to select the one with the history on it, and I'm going to put that in the originals folder. And I'm going to use the one I just duplicated without the history for my manipulation. So I'm going to go to edge mode. And I keep, what's happening here is I'm trying to select all the edges, and I keep selecting the edge of the tire trim. So there we go. I go flat so I can see it. And I select one edge, shift select the next edge, it selects the whole ring. There we go. Good stuff. Now I'm going to go out into the front viewport, and I'm going to say edit mesh extrude. And it puts my manipulator where I don't want it. And I'm going to scale this thing down. And then in. Using my little profile here as the guide. Okay. Hit the G key to do it again. Gonna go to world mode. Scale it down. Just trying to keep it kind of uniform to the parameterization that's already there. Okay. Let's hit G again. And the thing's actually doing it perfectly on its own. So I'm going to hit G again. Scale it down. This time I need to scale it in. G again. World mode. Scale it down. And I'll scale it a little bit. And let's just do one more for good measure. Okay, so there we go. We got our tire built with the sidewall. With the correct number of treads. And yeah, again, I made a miscalculation on my tread itself. And so they're a little bit spaced farther apart than they should be. But it's okay because the principle is there. So now we have the tire. I'm going to go ahead and say center the pivot. And it also turned out a little bit wider than I thought I wanted, but that's also okay. Because all I have to do is scale it up into position, and then I can scale it down to match by room. And it's a no big deal. Poly count should be relatively low. Because this is about as optimal as you can design such an asset. So I'm going to guess that it's about 2,500 to 4,000. $4,600, so pretty close. So $4,600 for something like that was not really bad at all. And then it should also render pretty clean. So the process for you guys is identical to this. Again, I did this demo because I wanted to show one with a sidewall because I know not all tires have the racing profile. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and save my scene. And I'm thinking the scale might have been right. Yeah. It's coming pretty close to my... Yeah, something weird happened there. Oh, that's the bend. Okay. So that was my original guesstimation dimension right there. So I just want to... I'm going to scale it down to get inside of there. And then... Okay. I'm going to go ahead and save this. The next step is going to be to model the rim. Did everyone get that, or do you want to see anything else on the tire? Or see anything again? Basically, the key is finding your repetition. I like doing the math, though, because then it allows you don't end up with any surprises at the end. And it's also very easy. So if I did want to change that tread to be wider in the box itself, it wouldn't be nothing for me to go ahead and redo this. All right, so I'm going to pause this for a second and set up for the next tutorial. So this is the rim we're going to build here. In a previous demo, we showed you guys how to model the nut here, the hub nut. And so in this demo, what I want to do is cover how to model the rest of the shapes, this kind of like little lug cap thing, whatever it is. And then this, and then this, and then these shapes here. All right, so I'm going to simplify this a little bit to get through it. If you guys want, I will show you a more detailed version of the demo at any time. So let's go ahead and go into the front viewport. And what I've done here is I've sectioned off a 72-degree section for my rim. Because the rim has five hubs, which if you divide 360 by 70, or by 5, you come up to 72. So I know that all I have to do is model 72 degrees of this rim, and then all the rest of it is going to be the same. So I only have to model basically one-fifth of it and then duplicate it in order to get the rest of it. So then what I did was I drew from my reference image, I dropped down a bunch of profile curves to represent different areas on the rim itself. And I put those in three dimensions so that I could kind of get a depth front to back for how my rim is actually constructed. All right. Once we have that, then we're able to go ahead and generate an actual profile curve for the rim and all the shape curves to get the shape. So the first shape that we have is this kind of pattern here, which is kind of the inverted version of the hubs for the rim itself. So I've already drawn the shape. I did it to the reference image. And again, the perspective was such that you kind of have to guesstimate. So mine doesn't line up exactly, but the image wouldn't line up exactly. So I had to kind of fill in the blanks. So I've drawn my curve here. I did it as a linear CV curve, and I dropped the exact number of edges that I needed to define the shape as if I was going to convert this to a polygon from the get-go, which I knew I was. So then once I had that, then all I have to do is take my profile curve, which approximates what happens at the edge of this feature here, and I'm just going to go ahead and do an extrusion along this path. So the other cool thing about this is that I don't even have to model 1/5 of the rim. I only have to model 1/2 of 1/5 of the rim, because inside of the 1/5, it's also symmetrical. So I can go ahead and do things like select my shape curve here, and I don't even need to cut it. I can just go to Control Vertices, and I can delete one side of it. And then I know that this thing will be symmetrical from side to side. So I'm going to do that. I'm going to select my profile curve and my shape curve, or my shape curve and my profile curve. And I'm going to say, I'm going to go into surfaces mode. I'm going to say surfaces, extrude. And I want to open up my settings to make sure everything's correct. Tube, at path, component, profile normal, polygon as the output geometry, control point as a tessellation method, and then I'm going to say apply. So once I do that, I have the shape here of what is basically this. I could go ahead and fill this in very easily at this point, and I'll do that. I'm going to select the edge, and I can't do the loop because it's on the border. So I'm just going to select all these edges, and then I'm going to go ahead and say, go to polygon mode, edit mesh, extrude. I'm going to go to world mode. I'm just going to pull this down because I don't care where it goes. I'm going to go into vertex mode. I'm going to select all these vertices, and then I'm going to say edit mesh, merge to center, and it's just going to pop all those vertices to be a point. Now I'm going to hit the W key to move the vertices, and then I'm going to hold down the C key for snap to curve, and I'm just going to snap it here to my guide curve, and that's at the center of the rim. There we go. We've got that feature built. Okay, so the next feature is the hub that is at the base of this, so at the center of the rim. So what I want to do here is I want to count the number of edges that I have at the front of this little hub thing that I have. And I'm going to do that so I can figure out how many edges I want this section to have when I'm done with it. So I selected them all. It's got 8. So that means there's going to be a total of 16 once I duplicate this for each 72 degree segment of rim. Okay. So what I want to do here is I want to, I want my NURBS circle to have 18 times 5 control vertices, so that when I go to sew this one to this one, I'm going to have the correct number of edges for my bridge. Does that make sense? Okay. So I've actually already done this, but let's just show you how that would work. So I'm going to select the circle. I would go to Surfaces, Edit Curves, Rebuild Curve, Linear, and then for the number of spans, I would put 80. Say Apply. And then if I right-click on this, you can see here that we have 80. And the cool thing about it is they also, the vertices coincide perfectly with my guide curves here. So what I want to do here is I'm going to go into the front view, and I'm going to select my guidelines and my circle, and I'm going to say edit curves, cut curve. Oh. And before I do that, I want to delete the history on this thing. Edit curves, cut curve, I'm going to check my settings. Use direction, active view, apply. And of course, I end up with some weird. Another way to do this is I'm having issues here. I don't like what's going on. I can just simply select control vertices. And delete them. And then edit curves, open close curves. Hold on. It's not gonna work. Okay, so I've cut my curve here. And now what I want to do here is I have a profile that I drew that basically represents this little curvature right here of the rim. And I only want to extrude it along this semi-section, 72 degrees of our rim. So I'm going to select my shape curve and my profile. And then I'm going to say surfaces, extrude. I know my settings are sound from the previous one. So I'm going to go ahead and say apply. Okay, that looks pretty good. We are actually getting pretty close to being done with this rim, surprisingly. So the next thing I want to do is I'm going to select the curves that I've drawn to represent this shape here. And I'm going to select both of those. Again, I drew them out perfectly. I planned them. So I'm using only the minimum number of control vertices that I need in polygons. So it's kind of before I ever built the thing in NURBS, I knew that I was going to tessellate the polygon. And so I kind of planned out the number of edges I wanted to use. So now I've selected these curves, and I'm going to grab them both, and I'm going to say surfaces, loft, output geometry, polygon, tessellation method, control point, and there we go. So it maintained the number of control vertices for it. That looks good. How are we doing on time? Simplified method. Okay, so the next thing I want to do is I'm going to select the edges. Actually, if I just select one and shift select, I'm going to select all of them. And what I want to do is extrude this thing backwards to finish my rim. So now that I have all my edges, I'm going to say surfaces, extrude. Oops. We need to be in polygon mode. I want to go to Edit Mesh, Extrude. I want to do it in World. And I'm going to go over here into my viewport. And I'm going to extrude these backwards to be the base of the rim. I'm going to then go into Vertex Mode. And I'm going to grab all these vertices. And I just want to flatten those out. And then move them back to basically be flush with that little hub right there. Okay, so now I have all my components in place. The rim is essentially done. Now all I need to do is select my faces here. I'm going to delete this side. I'm going to go into face mode on this guy, and I just want to delete these faces here, and these faces here. Looking good. I want to check all my face normals on all these parts. So I'm going to say face normals. I want them all to be oriented in the same direction. You can see here that these two are backwards. So I'm going to go into normals, and I want to flip the normals or reverse. I'm going to make a button to do that because I'm doing it constantly. There we go. And I can turn off the face normal. All right, we're looking good. The last thing I want to do here is I want to go into vertex mode on each one of these. And in the front, the orthographic front viewport, I just want to make sure that these verts line up with my section line. Because when you get into NURBS modeling, or any modeling for that matter, even if I was doing poly modeling here, I might end up with some of these vertices not lining up with my section curve. And if I take the time to do this now, it's basically going to save me a bunch of headaches when I start trying to merge vertices afterward. So I did that on all of them. Okay, that looks good. So now all I want to do is mirror each one of these elements to make up the other half. I'm going to center the pivot on this one. I'm going to hit insert, hold down the vertex snapping, snap it to its edge, and then I'm going to go to mesh, mirror geometry. I want to turn off merge vertices because it does that nonsense where it collapses them and you have no way to control the threshold. So I'll do it just to make sure my vertices are welded. I'm going to select them. I'm going to say mesh or edit mesh, merge, okay? And I'm going to do the same thing for each one of these. So it's mesh, mirror geometry, vertex, edit mesh, merge, whoops, too big of a threshold. So these are probably going to be outside the threshold, so I'm just going to grab both vertices and instead of merging them, I'm going to say collapse or merge center. Okay, got all those merged. Just got one more to do, mesh, mirror, vertex. These are, again, too close for comfort, so I'm just going to do these manually. Okay. Oh, that's interesting. I don't know how I did that, but I'm sure I did it. Delete. Okay, so now all we need to do to finish off the rim is grab these individual pieces. I'm going to duplicate them first, and I'm going to make a copy. And now I'm going to go ahead and select this one and this one, and I'm going to say mesh combine. Now if I go into edge mode, and I select all these edges, and if my math was correct and I didn't make any mistakes, I can go into bridge and they pop together perfectly. Okay, so let's get that to happen one more time, please. Mesh, combine, edge. Again, this is a simplified version of this. If you model in this manner, you can add all sorts of detail. And this is really controlled modeling. This is where, yeah, you can model anything. It just takes a little longer, which is why I can't cover it completely during the lecture. But hopefully I'm showing you enough to where if you wanted to, you could digest this and use it yourself. So I'm going to say bridge. There we go. They're perfect. Alright, so now I'm going to go ahead and center the pivot on this thing. I'm going to move it down to my origin, which I've been using faithfully as the center of my world, which also allows me to do things like this, duplicate, rotate, negative 72. Let's check the gaps, make sure that this is cool. Oh, that's really good. Okay. And then now that I've done that, let's see if it'll work with duplicate with transform. No, never does. I believe the key with duplicate with transform, guys, is that you have to do it all in one motion. So you have to hit Control D, rotate it, and you can't deselect it. So if I do it that way and I say duplicate with transform, there we go. So if you deselect it, then it doesn't work anymore. So Shift D, there we go. We got our entire rim. I'm going to borrow the nut from the other one. And then all we have to do is combine all these. Weld the center lines, which I'm going to skip for time. And then I have my profile curve here, which I drew for the inner rim. Make sure that's centered on my center line. It is. And then I can say mesh or edit mesh or nope. Keep making that mistake. Surfaces, revolve. And the only issue I have here is that my rim is coming down through my mag, which I can easily fix by getting a hold of that curve. Oops. Control vert. See if I can get it. Control vertex. There we go. And now all I have to do is go in here to the side view and cinch that up and out of the way. And there we go. We got our rim. I'm going to go ahead and save this. I'm going to export it.
If we have the brake showing behind it, can we put that in there?
Yeah, you can model the brake caliper. Yeah, you can make that as a separate model. I definitely would not model stuff like that until you have your entire car built and looking good. Those are kind of more like secondary details that you might even add later after this class for your portfolio. So let's say... Yeah, if you have your car not done, but you have a brake caliper, I'm not going to be very happy. Although that's great, that's not really in the spirit of a... So let me just export the selection as an OBJ. I'm going to do it as a temp. All right.
I'm going to use out your outer end of the rim and select both the CV circle and then it revolve.
No, I actually, I use these circles that I drew as kind of a shape reference, and then I drew a curve, a profile curve that kind of matched based upon those.
And then because your pivot was in the center.
Yeah. When I did the revolve, yeah, it revolves it around. And so it's a bunch of different sections, but, you know, it fools the eye because they're all intersected. And, it's really clean, and then the way this thing's built, you could also round all the edges very easily just by adding a few extra steps. So you could get photoreal film grade model and not a lot of time. All right, so I just want to marry the two models that we built today. So There's my tire, now I'm going to import my rim. And you can see here I got them both the different sizes. That's okay, because I'm going to center the pivot. I'm going to scale it up. Oh man, and somehow I missed the actual rim. Let's export the tire. There we go. So this is another good example of I built these things in different files. Totally acceptable for you guys to do that. It can be, you know, these scenes can get pretty complicated, and you know, the more objects you have in them, the harder it can be to organize everything. So it's very acceptable as long as you're mindful of proportion. To bring them in and then marry them to each other later. So there we go. I've got, okay, rim and tire together. Let's go ahead and give that a render. Cool. And that looks crappy because I have don't have any surface normal smoothing on it yet. And I believe the rim maybe, the rim isn't going to work because I didn't add an extra step. But if you add an extra step to this process, you can make it so every single model you create will also take a smooth. So this is how Donovan's modeling his car. I like that he's doing this. If I did an extra step where I filleted everything, then it would be to a point where the entire thing would smooth. And so you basically have kind of an infinite resolution asset that also works as a low poly asset, because the control cage is kind of modeled with the minimum number of edges necessary to define the object. So I submit that if you model in this manner, even though it may take a little bit more time, you will not end up doing redos. And you'll also have it in various stages where if someone asks you to change something, it's really not going to be that hard to do. So, and right now you're the one asking yourself to change things. So yes, save yourself some time. All right, cool. That concludes the tire and rim demo. And so hopefully this week you guys are going to be able to do that for yourselves. Again, I want to throw in the caveat that if you have a method that you're more comfortable other than this, and this method you're not picking it up fast enough in order to complete the assignment, then by all means, do it your way and get the assignment done. Yeah. And I'm going to put Mike Williams' videos up on the hard drive or Kong folder as well, so that if you're more comfortable, he's more of a box modeler. So if you're more comfortable with that method, you have two different methods to refer to. That's it.